Hello, welcome back to the Dezarticast. You might remember that a few months back we did an episode on the May 68 revolts in which we used extensively an essay by Vladimir Borțun. Recently, he gave an interview for Caiet magazine, which made me realize that he's also part of Buna de Lucru, or The Workforce, an organization that I've been following for quite some time. I appreciated Buna de Lucru even back when I was much more uncomfortable with revolutionary politics, because from their messaging I could see a clear path to power, and especially one that wouldn't throw oppressed groups under the bus, but join them in their struggle. So, I just had to ask him to come on our show. Since we cover a lot of subjects pertaining to internationalism, like globalization, Brexit, secession movements, and transnational cooperation of political parties, it was only fair to conduct this interview in English. I hope you'll get past my Iliescu English and enjoy what I think was a very interesting conversation.
You did an MA in UK and you are now living in Barcelona, right?
Yes, I started with philosophy in Bucharest, University of Bucharest. I did political philosophy for bachelor and master degree, which was political philosophy very much in the Western canon of analytical liberal philosophy. And then I worked for a few years as a translator, as a research assistant, mostly part-time jobs. And then I went to the UK and I did a master in European studies, which I saw it as a more applied approach to politics, so a kind of transition from political philosophy to political science. Mm-hmm. And then after that, I did my PhD also in political science.
Both of your parents had left intellectual origins, so you were a red diaper baby, so
yeah,
to say.
Yeah.
And that's how you ended up getting more into Marxism. During your development, because it was a very dearth of Marxists and Marxist literature in your education in Romania, I guess.
Yeah, and as you can imagine, the 90s when I grew up, I'm born in 86. It was a completely monopolized climate, ideological climate by the right wing. Various shades of right, from the ultra neoliberal right coming from the West to crypto fascist right with nostalgia for the interbellic era. But there was nothing on the left. So I had a huge luck, huge advantage to have Marxist literature in the house and to have a father that kind of introduced me to that. Also, to have a good relationship with my father, you know, because if I had a bad relationship, maybe I would have wanted to be the opposite of what he was, you know, like a kind of anti-father revolt. You can see, I don't know, maybe it's not a fair example, but you can see Tismaneanu, you know, he's somebody that went completely against the politics of his own father. And I think that there's been some interesting analysis of this from a psychological point of view of this relationship that he has and how that translated into his political views. I think it was published on Critic Attack a few years ago. Anyway, I had this luck that to have this in the house, you know, to have this influence. But I remember I came to the to a left consciousness, so to speak, around the age of 13, when I read not Marx, but Panaiti Strati, who is one of the big Romanian writers and one of the big left Romanian intellectuals of the last century. And I read one of his, I think it's a novella, it's not a proper novel. It's called Ciulinii Băraganului, which I don't know how to translate in English.
Băragan's Thorns?
Yeah, something like that, yeah. Which is set in the historical context of the 1907 peasant revolt in Romania, which was caused by brutal poverty and brutal exploitation of the population that was still mostly composed of landless peasants. And they raised up across the country, across, I think, particularly in the south. That's why it's located in Băragan, which is this this flat land north of the Danube, and the revolts were particularly strong there, and they were crushed with brutal repression by the authorities of the time. And this kind of ignited in me something, you know. And I think this is how, in my case, but in the case of most people, I assume, this option for the left starts as a moral sentiment, so to speak, as a sentiment of outrage, of solidarity, of compassion, and so on, which later you try to rationalize and to give it a theoretical articulation, right? An ideological articulation and scientific foundations, and you try to reach scientific arguments for why the left to kind of justify your left position, and to try and change the world. You need to try and change the world through a scientific method, in my opinion, rather than pure wishful thinking. But I think it starts from a feeling of outrage, from a feeling of indignation towards the world we live in, and then gets a theoretical, if you want, an a posteriori theoretical rationalization. I don't know anybody who started who said, okay, I read all the arguments of the right and the left, and rationally, logically, I arrived to the conclusion and the left arguments are correct, so I'm going to be left-wing, you know? I think this comes afterwards.
I think that people who are really academicizing their politics might be, I don't know, good academics, but they're certainly not good political operatives. They're not good organizers. They're not good politicians. You need that outrage towards injustice to have that fire. Keep going.
Exactly. So that's how that was my, if you want, my introduction to a left consciousness. This was my, through literature, through art. And I think this is an important thing that maybe the left need to use a bit more, you know, the means of the literature, of music, of movies, and so on, other artistic means to convey its message. Maybe it's not doing that enough at the present time. But then, of course, I wanted to go deeper than that and to try and understand why this injustice exists, why the system is the way it is, and how we can change it. So I started to read Marx. At about the age of 14, I read the Communist Manifesto, and it had an immediate impact on me. It was so clear and so convincing and so relevant. Written 150 years before, I actually read the Romanian translation of it that marked the 150th anniversary of since the publication in 98 by a publishing house called Nemira. I don't know if it still exists.
Yeah, it
and,
exists.
it still exists. I know they used to have some issues with bankruptcy and not paying their translators, but it's good.
They're mostly sci-fi publishing, and they're run by a pretty anti-communist lady.
Okay. Well, you could tell that already from that 98 translation, because they had some commentaries at the end of the book written by Romanian intellectuals. And apart from Ion Ianoși, who was a Marxist philosopher who died a few years ago, and Radu Cosașu, who, you know, he's a Romanian publicist as well on the left, but not very, let's say, explicitly on the left. We know he's on the left, but he's not necessarily trying to make a left-wing case in his articles. He publishes in Dilema Veche. And also, he writes football articles as well for Gazeta Sporturilor. Apart from that, all the other commentators who wrote texts in that book were on the right. And it was a reflection, if you had, of the current ideological climate. But of course, I didn't mind those articles. I read the text of Marx and Engels, and I found it 150 years later so incredibly relevant for both how capitalism works on a national basis, but also, and this kind of hints to some of the things that I think we're going to discuss about today, the internationalist perspective. And that's why the manifesto ends the way it ends, you know, with that call to arms for the address to the international proletariat, to workers of all countries unite. Yeah. I think this is key to socialism and to any kind of attempt to change the world.
But you said in that interview at CAED that until the financial crisis, you're still left reformist.
Yeah. On the one hand, I had this kind of theoretical abstract allegiance to Marxism, and I had my Che Guevara t-shirt and all that kind of stuff, you know. So I thought, I would want a revolution, but the conditions for that are not present at today in the world we live today. Capitalism is too powerful today. So the best we can hope for is a gradual reformation of capitalism that at some point will maybe change into a different system, into a socialist system. And this is, if you want, the position of the first wave of revisionism of the kind likes of Bernstein, of German social democracy at the end of 19th century, who said that basically through gradual reforms within the framework of bourgeois democracy, of liberal democracy, through parliamentary reforms, we can in time overcome capitalism and replace it with socialism. So if you want, broadly speaking, this was my view at the time. But of course, one of the fundamental flaws of this position is that it ignores the inherent tendency of capitalism to crisis. And this means that whenever it goes into a crisis, first of all, each crisis almost is worse than the previous one. So it's more because of globalization and so on, the impact is greater every time. It's more systemic. So the effects on the living standards of people, on jobs and wages and public services and so on, is greater and greater and greater with each crisis. So capitalism cannot deliver the kind of reforms that social democrats like Bernstein, 100 and something years ago, but unfortunately, much of the so-called radical left today believes it's possible. You know, these reforms are not possible. Or if they are possible, they are only possible on a short term in the context of a system that goes from crisis to crisis. So basically, for me, that crisis opened my eyes. You know, I saw, whoa, wait a minute, what's this? This is not just some bankers who got greedy and put their hands in the, try to have more of the pie that they deserved. People try to frame it in a moralistic framework, you know, it was about greed, it was about a few individuals who, no, it was a systemic failure. And it had its roots in the 1970s, if you want, when the crisis of kind of industrial capitalism started, and they tried to kind of address that crisis through the financialization of capitalism, which led to this over-reliance on credit and consumption and financial speculation and so on. So I think the crisis was only, if you want, itself was a manifestation of a deeper systemic crisis that started a few decades before.
Yeah. Even Rosa Luxemburg hinted at this, intuited at this in her writings on depth and on imperialism. The crisis is indeed a major moment. What I find really striking is that even if it shows the internal contradictions of the system so powerfully, there are still revisionist tendencies. So like I read Jason Hinkle's The Divide, and it mapped out really convincingly and thoroughly in a more or less mainstream economics language the way that the center core periphery global system works. And at the same time, it couldn't get out of, I don't know, not quite liberal, but it couldn't imagine the kinds of ways the systems need to be changed. It's part, I really like the book Up Until the Solutions, which depressed me immensely because they are so puny, like, and not structured in any way. He was just throwing a few ideas randomly, like, oh, maybe we can convince the bankers to forgive the debt, and maybe we can give a UBI, and it was so shallow, and I don't get how you can map so thoroughly the way that the center exploits the peripheric and semi-peripheric countries and did this for centuries, and you can think that, oh, maybe we can convince them to forgive our debt and it will be all okay.
Exactly.
And even I don't know, Mark Blythe, I'm reading Austerity now, and he is also criticizing this very moralistic tendency in people to moralize the crisis, and he's vehemently against this, but he's still basically just a Keynesian.
Exactly.
It's depressing.
It's very depressing, and it's very frustrating because, like you say, they have a very good diagnosis of the problem, but the treatment is rubbish because they refuse to draw the correct conclusions from their own analysis, and this is frustrating. For example, I read a couple of years ago a book, a similar book about the Troika in the Eurozone and the neoliberal architecture of the Eurozone and how it structurally favors Germany and other export-based economies, you know. And it was written by Lapavitsas, which is this Greek, he says Marxist economist, who was actually a Syriza MP in the first Syriza government in 2015, but then he left because of the capitulation of the Tsipras government in front of the Troika. And he wrote this book together with a German economist, Flassenbeck. And they make a superb analysis of the Eurozone and how it's basically unreformable. So they call for an exit from the Eurozone and even from the EU, but the Eurozone is their focus. But then they don't go far enough, you know, into saying that this is not just a problem of design. It's a problem of the system, of the capitalist system, where some countries, in this case Germany, but other countries as well, Netherlands, Sweden, and so on, will always try to benefit from the, let's say, less advanced countries, the weaker countries, economically speaking. This is how capitalism works. It's ruthless competition. You cannot convince, like you said, how can you expect to convince the powerful countries to be less competitive? Come on, don't be so competitive. Let Italy and Spain and Greece to do some profit as well. Let them have some of the export market. No, this is pure naivety. It's pure irresponsible wishful thinking. And that's why Europe cannot be united on a capitalist basis, because these countries that form the European Union are fundamentally driven by the interests of their capitalist class, of their national capitalist class. And of course, you have some overlap of these national capitalist classes. You have multinational corporations and so on. But at the end of the day, the main framework of reference for all these capitalists is their national framework. So, and you'll see in times of crisis, German capitalism will try to defend the interests of German capitalism. U.S. capitalism under Trump, with all the protectionist measures and so on, tries to defend the interests of U.S. capitalism. But, of course, there are contradictions there as well. We can go into, but it just shows that the illusion of trying to create a united Europe on a capitalist basis. It's a contradiction.
Even if you somehow could meld all the countries together, there'd still be China. Like, there'd still be other very powerful capitalist countries, because China still operates in a, at the very least, in a capitalist division of labor, if not in a total capitalist system. And that's where I think these reformist thinkers kind of fail, because they only look at property. And when I started reading Marx and reading even Adam Smith, and to understand better his Marxist polemics with Smith, I noticed that the division of labor was a very important part in their thinking, and it's something that's kind of missing from more recent economistic thinking, like from, I don't know, Keynes and so forth, and that's important both at the micro level, how firms are managed, for example, the social level, the social division of labor, like the difference between racialized kind of labors or gendered works, or even at the international division of labor, because you have this core periphery division where basically the periphery countries function almost like an assembly line for the core countries. So it's a country that's mostly producing cotton, it's a country that's mostly turning that cotton into cloth and so on and so forth. We shouldn't look only at money, only at property. We should look at how the labor that creates that money and that property is structured. Yeah.
How diversified the economy is. You cannot you cannot, so to speak, catch up with the advanced countries when your economy is focused on one sector or two sectors. And that's the problem. The advanced countries don't want you to develop a diversified economy. They need you to do only this because that's what fits their own needs, their own economic needs. That's why, yeah. Again, another fundamental idea for Marxists and for revolutionaries, I think, in general, is that you cannot have countries like Romania, peripheral countries, semi-peripheral countries like Romania, catching up, so to speak, catching up with the West, because the West doesn't want to let them catch up with it. You know what I mean? Yeah, they need these economies to be managed in such a way that it serves their interests, not the interests of the peoples in those countries. It has to serve the interests of the advanced countries. So you, like you said, you produce cotton, you produce oil, you produce this, you produce that. It's a division of labor that fits the needs and interests of the advanced or the core countries. For example, Venezuela is given these days as such an example of socialist failure, right? First of all, it was never real public ownership over all the key industries in all the key sectors of the economy, which is a first necessary condition of a socialist society. Many sectors were still owned by private companies. And secondly, of course, the democratic control also was, which is for me the second biggest component of socialism, was lacking from the beginning. It wasn't a truly bottom-up socialist society at any point, whether it's under Chavez or Maduro. You never had it. On the contrary, under Maduro, the bureaucratic control only intensified. But the key, to keep it in the economic at the economic level, there was never a real public ownership of the economy in Venezuela. And there was a very, very almost exclusive reliance on the oil industry. And that's because this was an inheritance from the previous regimes, which only developed really the oil industry in Venezuela, because that's what the interests of North American capitalism dictated. Obviously, we know that Latin America is the area of hegemony for one of the areas of hegemony for North American capitalism. And the countries there produce what fits the interests of North American corporations. And Venezuela was one of the oil countries, oil producing countries, because that's what fitted the interests of North American capitalism. So they didn't have time to develop other sectors of the industry. And one of the big mistakes of the Chavez government was to not do that, not to try and repair that historical deficit, you know, of not having other developed industries. And they continued relying on the oil industry. And of course, when the oil prices started to drop a few years ago, that's had a disproportionately big impact on Venezuelan economy and society.
Yeah. So I think we are getting now to one of the stronger tensions in international politics now. The capacity of countries to self-manage and to develop when they are so embedded in an international globalized system. So there's a tension, I think, between even a progressive nationalism, the one that Benedict Anderson talks about in Imagined Communities, for example, we might see in the after Brexit, either in the opportunity of Lexit, which was kind of missed, if it was there at all, in the secession of Scotland from the UK, which I think they're going to have another referendum, and the secession of Catalonia from Spain. I think how does this progressive nationalism fit with internationalism?
That's a vital question, I think, for the present period we are in. I think one thing I would want to say is that as Marxists, as socialists in general, it's important to recognize the fundamental right to national self-determination. I think that's important. Or I think all national groups have the right to, if they want, to create their own state. That's why, for example, after the 1917 revolution, one of the first things that the Bolsheviks did once they got power was to give right to national self-determination to the numerous oppressed national groups across the Russian Empire. And this is something that mainstream historiography tries to ignore. At the time when Woodrow Wilson was talking about the right of nations to be independent and so on, the right to self-determination. Actually, if we go a bit into depth, Wilson only did that to counter the success that the Bolsheviks were having by the popularity that they were gaining by promoting that principle of national self-determination. Of course, this principle was later violated when Stalin rose to power and of many things changed. Many fundamental 180-degree shifts happened under Stalin, including this idea socialism in one country. And this is where I come to this idea of progressive nationalism, which I don't believe in. I believe in national liberation struggles. So I believe in the right of oppressed national groups that have been subjected to imperialist oppression for many years to emancipate themselves from that oppression, to win national self-determination. But at the same time, I believe that national self-determination on its own is not very valuable if it's you replace the oppression of a foreign capitalist class with the oppression of a national capitalist class.
Yeah.
So I think national self-determination has to be joined by socialist, by the struggle for socialist transformation of society. And this is something that me and the organization that I'm a member of internationally, which has been recently renamed the International Socialist Alternative, this is what we stand for everywhere. In Catalonia, for example, where I live at the moment, yes, we call for an independent Catalonia, but we call for a socialist independent Catalonia. Because a capitalist independent Catalonia won't make much of a difference for the poor people in Catalonia, for the precarious workers in Catalonia, for the immigrants without papers who are subjected to racism on a daily basis in Catalonia and so on. So I think these two go together hand in hand. Now, the idea of progressive nationalism, I think, is rooted in this idea of in Stalinist idea of it's not necessarily the same. I don't want to say that all the people who promote the idea of progressive nationalism are Stalinists, but I think the legacy comes from this idea of socialism in one country, which yeah. means basically that you can build socialism without a worldwide international revolution. You can build socialism just in Russia or just in Hungary or just in Romania. I don't think that's true. I think fundamentally, and as history proved, you cannot build socialism when you are surrounded by capitalist countries, which will inevitably suffocate you economically and politically, and you'll end up in a dead-end street. And it would be interesting to go maybe into more detail, not now necessarily, but why Stalin adopted that theory of socialism in one country. Of course, because the message underlying that theory was that we can build it in Russia. We don't need the German working class to conquer power in Germany, like Lenin and Trotsky used to say, who were very aware that you cannot really build socialism in Russia if socialist revolutions are not accomplished in other advanced countries, which would later help Russia to develop its economy. They were aware of that. Whereas Stalin said, no, we don't need revolutions in other countries. We can build it here in Russia. Who? Us, the bureaucracy. You can rely on us to build socialism. We don't need other working classes around the world to help us build socialism. We can build socialism. But by we, they obviously meant them, the bureaucracy. So this was a theoretical attempt to kind of rationalize and justify their own position of power and privilege and so on. But this is another discussion. I just wanted to touch upon that briefly. This progressive nationalism misses the fundamental fact that we've already touched upon, that you cannot have a successful struggle for socialism on a single country basis, on a national basis. You need internationalism. I mean, it's not just that internationalism is nice, you know, it's cool, you know, it's cool to be internationalist and so on. It's those things as well. Yeah, it's nice to be internationalist. It's cool. But fundamentally, it's necessary. It's from a pragmatic, purely pragmatic point of view that we understand the need for internationalism. I think a Brexit from the left, a socialist Brexit or a socialist exit, regardless of the country where it would take place, an exit from the EU, that is, would necessarily have to link up with other similar movements in other European countries and not simply reject the European Union, but propose as an alternative to the European Union a different type of European cooperation, a different type of European international kind of coordination, you know? So I think that one of the ideas that emerged in the last few years, which unfortunately hasn't been developed enough, but which I think would have had the potential into developing into a kind of socialist, internationalist alternative to the European Union, was Plan B for Europe, which was an initiative called by certain left parties in Europe, such as Mélenchon's France Insoumise, the left bloc in Portugal, the red-green left in Denmark, some elements, more radical elements in Podemos from Spain, the split from Syriza in Greece, which is called Popular Unity. They came together after Syriza's capitulation and created this initiative called Plan B for Europe, where they said, we cannot rely on the willingness of the European institutions to make any concessions to our demands, because we saw how they reacted to Syriza's relatively modest demands. Please, less austerity. No. Mm-hmm. You know? So we need a plan B, which means we need a scenario to exit the Eurozone and even the European Union, but in an international way, in a coordinated way. So we don't exit just us here in Portugal, just us here in Spain, because we would be crushed. We need to have an international, a transnational, if you want, alternative and scenario for an exit, which would entail the cooperation between different movements across borders. Of course, unfortunately, for many reasons, this wasn't developed into an actual political project. It remained a very party elite thing, a few conferences here and there, but nothing really, it didn't really catch on. So, but I think this would be a good start. We don't have to fall into a nationalist kind of national, progressive nationalist perspective, or accept the EU as it is and try to reform it with no coherent plan of how you can reform the EU. I think a third position is correct in this instance, and it would be an exit from the EU, but on an internationalist basis.
Yeah, embedded in some sort of international or organization and struggle. That's something I was skeptical about, the possibility of a Lexit, and I think many people were for a long time, because almost all the talk regarding the Lexit was done by people who had strictly internal objectives, like saving the NHS, privatizing the railways, and so on, without looking outside, which was, I think, very, very dangerous, especially since Brexit came on a very reactionary wave of against migrant workers and immigrants, and just looking inwards, it could be very dangerous to control that kind of forces.
I think the fact that these kind of discourses and forces, reactionary discourses and forces, ended up monopolizing the Brexit was mainly because the left allowed them to do that. They let them monopolize it. And this is the danger when the left fails, and not just in relation to the EU, in relation to any establishment, when the left fails to provide a credible, consistent opposition to the establishment, this will create a space for the far right to come in and say, okay, we'll be the opposition to the establishment. And unfortunately, history showed us that many people fall for that. They believe this false alternative that is put to their face, because they don't see the left putting any alternative, you know. So the left in Britain, much of the left, unfortunately, instead of saying, okay, let's organize a genuinely socialist, internationalist alternative to both EU and the Brexit of the reactionary far right and the populist right. No, they said, no, let's stick with the EU and try to reform it. This obsession, this fetish with the reforming the EU, which has been going on for decades on the left in Europe with no concrete results, and no concrete plans of how you can actually reform the EU. There's just abstract ideas about how we could have, for example, European taxation regimes and all these beautiful ideas, but no concrete strategy on how to change the balance of power that would allow for the implementation of those beautiful ideas, you know? This is something you've already hinted at the beginning of our discussion, this lack of a strategy of how to actually achieve that in the current balance of forces, you know? In other ways, a clear approach to the question of power. This lacks on the left today, unfortunately, on much of the left today, unfortunately. So I think, much of this success of the far right and populist right to capture the popular anti-establishment feelings, anti-EU, anti-Brussels, anti-whatever, anti-elite feelings, has to do not only, I'm not reducing everything to this, but I think this is the main factor, the failure of the left to actually do that, you know, the failure of the left to provide that alternative to the elites and to the establishment. Where the left managed to do that to a certain extent, like in here, in the Spanish state, with Podemos, the far right for a long period of time was practically inexistent because the left managed to create this idea of an alternative to the establishment, this party, Podemos, which attracted the anti-establishment feelings. But when Podemos started to be seen itself as becoming part of the establishment, which now it is, unfortunately, it is part of the establishment. There's no question about it. You see the rise of the far right. So it's like almost like a law, you know, it's almost like a physical law. When the left leaves the vacuum in terms of opposing the establishment, that vacuum will be quickly filled by other forces. Just not to just bash the left here, but also you mentioned something interesting about how the discourse around Brexit from the left was all about the NHS and all about what affects the British public, the British working class. And you saw that on the liberal side of the so-called the reformist side in relation to the EU, I mean reformist, those who wanted to remain, right? The remainers. They say we want to remain because we are European, because nationalism is a thing of the past and so on and so forth. We are internationalists and so on. But then when you would point to what the EU has done in Greece, where they waterboarded a progressive government, what the EU has done in other southern European countries, imposing brutal austerity on Portugal, Spain, and so on, they say, oh, but this didn't happen in the UK because we don't have the euro, you know? So all of a sudden, the internationalist perspective stops. It's all only about what the EU has done towards the UK. What the EU has done in relation to the UK, what the EU has done to other countries, to other peoples of Europe, to other working classes across Europe, with unemployment of 50% among young people in Greece and Spain, this doesn't matter anymore, you know? So it's a hypocritical, completely contradictory internationalism of this liberal type.
Yeah, it's strange. I think even the American liberals, so the liberals, not even the leftists, are much more critical of the EU than European ones. Like Vox had various articles talking about the structural problems with the euro, and of course, because the problems are quite obvious, and it's easier to criticize something from the outside. And the liberals in the UK especially, I think they managed to gaslight much of the left to make it afraid to express itself. And I think the problem is that some portions of the left, which is already quite tiny and not very powerful, has these I don't know if Stalinist tendencies, but tendencies that are rooted in Cold War logic more than older ones, older traditions. Because, yeah, that's when they made their most of their progress. They did, and they want to return to the 60s and 70s.
It reveals, alongside that, it reveals a deep ignorance towards how the European Union was created. Of course, the narrative of legitimation was that oh, we need to bring peace and prosperity to Europe, so let's come together as a brotherhood of nations and so on and so on. But all hegemonic projects in history had this kind of narratives to justify themselves, right? To give them more legitimacy. But in reality, you had a few Western European capitalist elites, which after the Second World War were in a very delicate situation. They had to give huge concessions to the working class because of the balance of forces shifted after the Second World War. You had millions of people going back to their countries. They didn't want the same levels of poverty and inequality as before. That's why in Britain, for example, despite Churchill's huge popularity, he lost the elections in 1945, and you had a Labour government elected, the most radical government ever elected in that country in 1945, creating the NHS and so on. So there was a clear balance, a shift in balance of forces. Capitalist elites had to give a lot of concessions. Also, European colonialism was dying. Also, they had to counter the rising influence of the Soviet bloc over the continent. And they created this common market to kind of boost their profits and to try and make up, if you want, to compensate some way for the loss of colonies and for the loss of profit that they had to accept by creating the huge concession that was called the welfare state. A concession which they dismantled afterwards, after 1917s, when they were able to do so. So, which again shows the pure, if you want, the provisional character of any kind of reforms under capitalism.
At least if you don't keep a horizon in mind. But at the same time, I think it's quite unjust to ask of less developed countries like Romania to give up, I don't know, freedom of movement or the access to this common market if the left doesn't propose any sort of alternative to this. Like, there are various calls to, even on Critica Ta, where you wrote, there are articles criticizing the European Union and asking to leave the European Union, which, as you pointed out, just simply leaving the European Union, with especially with Romania as it stands now, would simply throw the Romanian working class to the Romanian capitalists, which are even more venal and violent than the international capitalists. So, what the national governments that have some left credentials to them, like you have in Spain now, or like hopefully the US will have, do you think they are signaling towards building this, or they are building towards something like this, or?
That's a very interesting question. I would just to start from what you said immediately before that about the case of Romania and other countries like Romania. To clarify what my position would be, I think one of the key things that we need to always have is being to be firm in the principles that we have and flexible in the tactics that we have in promoting or defending those principles. So I think for me, the principle of the EU not being reformable, the EU being a hopelessly capitalist project, is correct in every country, regardless whether it's Romania, Spain, or UK. But how we organize and how we put forward concrete demands towards that has to be different from country to country, because obviously the contexts are different. The strength of the labor movement and of the left in Romania is different from the strength of the labor movement and the left in Spain or in the UK. So in the current context in Romania, I wouldn't call for an exit from the EU tomorrow, because I know we don't have the social forces and the political forces to achieve the kind of exit that would be beneficial for the people, right? Like you said as well, if we do it on a capitalist basis, then who's going to benefit from it? The capitalist Romanian class? No, thank you. So we need to see what the balance of forces is. And in the current context, we don't have a favorable balance of forces for an exit from the EU. But at the same time, I think it's important to make the point that if at some point in the future we will have a left government, a genuinely left government, not PSD, obviously, that government will be put in the face of a choice. Either implements its left program, whether it will be a social democratic reformist program or a more socialist program, it's not really important in this point of the discussion, because we saw how Syriza's government has had very social democratic demands, very reformist, very moderate, and they were still opposed and crushed by the Troika. So what will happen in the case of a similar government in Romania? They will be similarly crushed and defeated by the European institutions if it doesn't have a scenario ready for exit. But then again, that exit, like we said, would only be possible on the basis of a socialist program, because if you exit from the EU and you will be surrounded initially, at least, by other capitalist countries, you will have to nationalize the economy, you would have to put control on capital circulation and nationalize the banking sector, the key sectors of the industry, so you make the economy work for the needs of the people in a much accelerated way that it would happen otherwise, you know? So in a way, the question of the exit of the EU puts on the table the question of socialist transformation in a much more abrupt and sharp way, I think. So yeah, just to sum up, I think in the case of Romania, a call for exit tomorrow would be premature, would be ultra-leftist, so to speak. But at the same time, we need to be honest and say, no, we don't think the EU is reformable. And we think at some point, a left Romanian government would have to be ready for an exit. Talking about Spain, I think here we have a situation where, so you have a capitalist party with a social democratic leftish shell, which has always, at least in the last 20, 30 years, I'm talking about PSOE here, the Social Democratic Party, always implemented the agenda of the capitalist elites. And actually, last year in the summer, if you remember, when they were still negotiating who to form a government with, they were flirting at the time with Podemos and the United Left, the Unidos Podemos coalition. But they met the representatives of the big business in Spain, who told them, no, you cannot have a coalition with Unidos Podemos. And then PSOE said, okay, we won't have a coalition with Unidos Podemos. So this shows clearly the interest that PSOE represents. Now they were forced into a coalition with Unidos Podemos because there was no other option left. And of course, big business doesn't like political crisis like this. They want some stability so they can make their profits, you know, they continue making their profits. So this was the least of the bad options that were available for them. And they joined the coalition with Unidos Podemos. Unidos Podemos, from a very weak position, in my opinion, they basically accepted to join the coalition without any guarantees that some of its own program will be implemented by this new coalition. There are some nice proposals there, but there's no clear commitment to those proposals. Let's remember, Syriza had nice proposals, and it wasn't the junior partner in the coalition. It was the big partner in the coalition. They still failed to implement them. And this created a crisis inside Podemos, because, and I agree with them, some elements, the more radical current inside the Podemos, which is called anticapitalistas, they said, no, the correct move would have been to remain in opposition and allow for a minority PSOE minority government. So basically abstain in the vote, which what the separatist parties have done anyway, the Catalan Basque separatist parties, and allow for the formation of a PSOE government, but we don't take part into that government. Because if that government will end up implementing more austerity measures, more neoliberal measures, then we won't be part of that. So now with Podemos in coalition with that, with that party, with PSOE, what will happen when this government will implement austerity measures and neoliberal measures? Who will benefit politically from that? Podemos will lose because it will be seen as part of the government that implemented those measures. And who is going to be out there to capture the disillusionment with the so-called anti-establishment party of the left, which is not anti-establishment anymore? Mm-hmm. It will be the far right. It will be Vox, which already is growing in polls because of that. So that's why you have this current inside Podemos, the anti-capitalistas, who are planning to, I think, it's quite looking like they will split from Podemos in the coming period. They already said they will refuse to attend the next party congress, which will be in spring, which is a clear signal that they are thinking about creating a new political force. And this was the current, this radical current was the only one inside Podemos that was putting forward any kind of strategy of confrontation towards the European Union. And this way I get to your actual question. Sorry, it took me so long. But this was the current that was involved in the Plan B initiative that I mentioned earlier, with other like-minded left forces across Europe that want this more kind of confrontational approach to the European Union. But if this current leaves Podemos, then you will basically have no such opposition towards the European Union inside Podemos. So we will be in the situation of basically two center parties, center left, let's say, one of them, who will be very obedient in implementing whatever the European Union demands of them. If their program, for example, will clash with the deficit rule of 3% of the GDP or other rules of the European Union legislation, then they will comply. They won't have anything within their own ranks to put pressure, if you want, on the leadership to fight the European Union. So the pressure can only come from outside. I wouldn't rely on Podemos or their partners, the United Left, which, as you know, is basically an electoral. It's like a political front of the Communist Party. So it's the Communist Party and Podemos that are this Unidos Podemos coalition. Mm-hmm. I don't expect any kind of pressure to come from within the ranks of these parties. Maybe from the very rank and file members of these parties, but I haven't seen much yet. So I think any pressure that can come on the current government to respect its program, to go beyond its program, which is quite limited, to resist any bullying tactics from the European Union and from other representatives of big capital, I think can only come from outside, from the trade union movement, from the new social movements that have been developing in Spain around women's oppression, around immigrants' rights, anti-racist movement. The youth movement is very strong here among students. The student organizations here are quite militant compared to other countries. So from this, I think, from this part, I would expect any pressure, any kind of resistance towards a potential clash between the government and the European Union institutions.
Especially since these kinds of organizations are a bit more flexible than political parties, I think. They change much quickly, they can grow much quickly, more quickly than parties, which are kind of constrained by the electoral cycle. So they kind of move in 4x4 year steps, so to speak. While more organic, issue-based movements can be more spontaneous, and I think they can collaborate internationally better. No?
This is interesting, actually. The transnational cooperation of social movements was something that in my PhD I touched upon. I didn't deal with it very much because I looked at the cooperation between the parties, but inevitably I looked at the cooperation between social movements, and actually it was interesting to find out that during the Eurozone crisis and the austerity period, so the 2010s decade that just ended, the level of transnational cooperation between social movements went down a lot in comparison to the internationalist level of cooperation of the previous movements, of the anti-globalization movements of the 1990s, of the Genova protest in 2001, you know. That generation, that movement, the anti-globalization movement, if you want, it was the first kind of articulation of an anti-capitalist consciousness after the 1989 end of history, so to speak. Mm-hmm. That was very internationalist. You had, I remember when I interviewed for my PhD, people from Syriza told me how as young people they went to Genova as a delegation to participate in the anti-G8 demonstrations, or even to Seattle before, 2 years before in 1999. And whereas the austerity had when the Eurozone crisis started 10 years later, had such a huge impact on the living standards, especially of the young people who are more likely to go to this type of mobilizations, that they didn't have, basically didn't have the resources to travel, to stuff, to engage in such transnational cooperation anymore. So the compared to the anti-globalization movement, which was super transnational in character, the anti-austerity movement was not really a movement, was movements. Was each one it's in its own country. You had the indignados in Spain, you had the anarchismeni in Greece, and you had the Occupy in United States, and then a smaller version in the UK. But these movements had very little points of contact and cooperation, other than, you know, basic stuff on the internet and so on. But they didn't really engage in a common struggle because they were so constrained by their own material conditions, economic conditions in their own countries, that the struggle became very national-based. So they struggled against their governments, against their bankrupt political elites, against the very passive trade union bureaucracy that wasn't really leading the fight, and so on and so on. And this is one of the big failures, if you want, of the anti-austerity struggle in this context of the Eurozone crisis. A return to the national framework instead of intensifying actually the transnational solidarity and cooperation, you know?
Yeah, you'd think that but no, women's rights issues or workers' rights issues or racial discrimination, problems with racial discriminations are transnational issues and could lead to much more cooperation. But yeah, the living standards and the constraint of the material conditions, I can see how they prohibit this. And now I think a lot of these organizations depend very much on international funding from liberal organizations. So, which they are co-opted in a way. It's a very difficult thing. And again, there are some voices that simply because queer advocacy groups get their funding from the EU, there are some socialists that think we should completely abandon them, and they are completely co-opted and embedded into the capitalist system, and LGBT groups simply are a form of bourgeois politics, which I don't agree with. But the people in those organizations need to approach their struggle like almost like a guerrilla fight, to pretend that that they're getting money simply to enact programs in accordance to the way the liberal organizations would want them to, and to keep an internationalist, intersectional, socialist horizon, and to link their struggles with the struggles of other oppressed groups and from most countries, which is something that's difficult. It's difficult.
Yeah, absolutely. Oppressed groups they have to use whatever resources they can put their hands on, and this means access to EU funding, then that be it. This doesn't automatically mean that you become an uncritical supporter of the EU. It could happen, it could lead to that, but it's not necessarily so. I think, for example, my own PhD was funded by EU money, but this didn't stop me of being critical towards the European Union. So I don't think it's a necessary relation there between getting funding. And by the way, where is that funding coming from? It's still coming from ordinary people.
Yeah.
From the taxpayers. So it's one of the few things that the European Union actually is doing well, to fund some of these groups. So I think it's a false problem raised by some people on the left.
Do you know of any organizations that can function as, I don't know, a sort of foundation for this this internationalist project to permit cooperation between various national groups, be they political parties or labor unions or so on?
So there is a network called Transform Europe Network, which is a political foundation of the Party of the European Left. The Party of the European Left is composed of left-wing parties from all across the European Union, and not only, beyond it's funded by the European Union, but some of the members can also be outside of the European Union. They have to be from Europe. So you have parties from Moldova as well and from other non-EU member states. And this is different from the political group of the left inside the European Parliament. There is a relation between the two, but they are distinct entities. And each European party has its own political foundation. And the political foundation also receives funding from the European Union institutions separately from the party that it represents. So the Transform Network Foundation is a Transform Europe Network. This is a complete name. Is this thing for the left, if you want. So they try to link up different movements, different trade unions, intellectual, academic networks, parties, of course, political foundations of other parties, because the bigger parties have their own political foundations, their own political think tanks. And if you want, this is a network of these political think tanks from different European parties. But as political think tanks, they are somewhere in between worlds, so to speak, you know. They are with one foot in the party politics and with one foot in the social movement and trade union kind of environments. So they are at an intersection. And Transform has been trying to do that. But unfortunately, actually, I studied Transform as part of my PhD. And unfortunately, despite their best intentions, they never managed to go beyond the level of semi-academic conferences with representatives of movements and trade unions and so on, quite inclusive, but always at the level of elite, kind of, you know, leaderships of the movements, of the trade unions, of the never having a mass component, you know, and mobilization component. Like, let's organize a demonstration, you know, or mm-hmm. let's organize a strike or an occupation or something. Nothing. Everything is at the level of conferences, debates, seminars, workshops, and so on. And I think this is important, of course, but it's not enough. The two have to be linked together. And that's why what we are trying now, our International Socialist Alternative, we try to always link the theory with the practice. They can't go one without the other. They feed upon each other. They are in a dialectical relation with one another. You cannot just have theory, or you cannot have just practice, you know. They are inseparable if you want to succeed. And by talking about funding, in our case, we completely rely on the funding of our members and our supporters, people on the street who agree with our ideas, and they donate €5, you know. And we never accept not that any capitalist ever offered any kind of donation, but if they would, we would never accept it. Just like Sanders in the United States, I think, did very well not to accept any money from millionaires and billionaires, because there is a risk there to get this, you know, for this money coming from people that you are fighting against, basically. You're not fighting against them as people, as individuals. You're fighting against the system they embody, right? The class they represent. You cannot accept money from them. It would be a contradiction, I think. And talking about funding, and I'm going to finish on this point on this particular aspect, I think is very important. And talking a bit, this also touches a bit upon how some of these parties, like Podemos, who start from the street, you know, and they end up part of the establishment. One of the key principles in our international is that if we have elected representatives, like in the parliament or in city councils and so on, like we have, for example, in Seattle, in the United States, or in Ireland, where we have two members of the parliament, they only take from the salary they get as elected representatives, they only keep the average salary of a worker in their country. And the rest, they give it to the movement. They give it to trade. They donate it to the party, to the trade unions, and so on and so forth. Why is that important? It's important because if you want to represent the interests of the working class, you cannot have a different life, completely different from the life of the working class. You cannot understand the needs and the problems and the struggles of the workers and of the oppressed groups if you live a different existence from them, you know, like in an ivory tower. If you don't know what the price of the bread is, or the price of the conditions on traveling on public transport and stuff like this, So it's not just like a demonstrative ethical thing to, oh, I only take the money of a worker back home. It's like a PR image stunt, you know? It's actually, again, a practical thing. You remain connected to the realities and to the life conditions of the people that you are supposed to represent.
That makes sense. I think it might be a bit idealistic, but it's a very nice sentiment, and it's a good way to secure some funding to the organizations, which is very important as well. So you've mentioned the parties that come from grass movement, and when talking about the situation in Spain, you are saying that there's a little internal opposition to the party getting to do the bidding of the capitalists. So another thing in your interview that I found interesting was your discussion of the concept of democratic centralism. There's a description here where you're talking about how these new parties kind of end up. I'm going to quote you: genuine debates and bottom-up flows of ideas are obstructed, and it's actually ironic how they invoke fuzzy things like horizontalism and grassroots democracy as opposed to the Leninist democratic centralism. This is something that I lived through firsthand, so I was a member of Demos for a few years. Your description, it really struck me. On the other hand, the party leadership kind of sees it a different way. Recently, Victoria Stoiciu and another person, Sergiu Gherghina, wrote an article, a pretty short academic article, about selecting candidates for deliberation, the effects for Demos in Romania. So this article talks about how Demos tried to implement horizontalism in its party and its effects, and they arrived at the conclusion that the risk is that the deliberative democracy becomes the dictatorship of those who accuse more, who blame more, and have a louder voice. One needs political education, maturity, and mutual respect to engage in deliberation, not partisanship that quickly leads to accusation of racism, sexism, and transphobia. And the unintended effects of deliberation includes high division within Demos and the weak legitimacy of candidates. It produced a bit of a whiplash effect, like under the auspices of horizontalism, I think the party was kind of ruled with a very informal lines of power, which weren't easy to question, couldn't really be held accountable, because technically we were going through this deliberating process and we were taking decisions in after debates and only after we were reaching consensus and so on. As you see, the party leadership kind of thinks that this was because some people were prone to make accusations of racism and sexism. But I think, from my point of view, the problem was that a lot of the decisions that were actually made weren't coming out of this deliberative process, out of the debates, out of the whatever we were doing, but the deliberation process was circumvented by the leadership, and this is how they mostly took the decisions. And don't know how does the democratic centralism address these problems? How does it encourages party democracy and makes the leadership accountable and not dictatorial? Or
there's always a tension, right, between democracy and efficiency and unity, and I think democratic centralism is the best compromise between these two. Why? Because on an internal level, so inside the party, you have the maximum possible level of debate and democracy. And this includes the possibility to form factions, to form tendencies, to form different platforms that then they can not compete, because it's not the right term, debate each other on ideas and principles and what to do as an organization. And I think this has to be encouraged as much as possible. And again, not only because of the sake of democracy, but also because of the sake of producing the best program, strategy, and tactics that you can, because this program, strategy, and tactics can only flow from this type of continuous debate, continuous clash of ideas and arguments. And this is what dialectics is at, basically, right? It's this constant clash between opposite arguments and ideas. And what stems from this is superior to both the A and non-A that were clashing before that, if that makes sense. So I think you can only reach the best approach, the best strategy, the best program, the best tactics, if you have this constant fight, if you want, struggle of ideas and arguments inside the organization. And sometimes this requires, as I said, the formation of tendencies and factions and so on, which I'm not sure if it was the case in the case of Demos. On the other hand, when there is a vote on a certain issue, when this debate has to reach a certain conclusion, so that because the party has to act upon it in its external activity, then the whole party comes together behind that decision. This doesn't mean that the debate is over, that decision is not reconsidered, reassessed, rediscussed, and maybe changed in the future. But it means that when they act together, when the party acts externally with other groups, with other movements, with the general public, with the political enemies, and so on and so on, it acts as one, as a cohesive, coherent unit, because otherwise you're not going to conquer power ever. So I think this is what these parties are not doing today. From what you say, from your description of Demos, I'm not very familiar with it, but from your description of Demos, it seems to be the opposite of that. It seems to be internally a very, and I'm talking about Podemos here, which funny enough has a very similar kind of history as Demos. Not only the names are very similar, but also it started like this project of left-wing academics from this university in Madrid. You know, Iglesias, Errejón, Monedero, they were the leaders, the heads of this project. And very soon they ended up in forming a clique inside the party. They were talking about super grassroots democracy. They established these things called circles, where anybody could form a Podemos circle depending on area or depending on the sector of activity. So carpenters could form a circle of carpenters, or people living in Albacete could form a circle in Albacete. But these circles, Iglesias even said, all power to the circles, you know, like quoting Lenin. But this didn't really happen. The power wasn't with the circles. It was with the leadership around Iglesias, Errejón, and a few others, super concentrated at the top of the party. And the decision-making process was very top-down. But in appearance, it looked like a super democratic party. But in reality, it was a very top-down party. And what happened externally? It happened that you could see the party acting in different ways. It didn't look like a coherent unit. And eventually, because of the struggle for power at the top of this party between Errejón and Iglesias, Errejón ended up leaving the party and creating his own political formation. And now you have the radical current inside Podemos who is looking like they want to go out as well. So what's the lesson from this is when you try to crush the internal debate and the internal democracy, this will inevitably result into public quarrels, into public arguments that reduce your credibility, reduce your appeal to the people, and at some point will result in splits and fragmentation, and destroying something even before you started building it properly, you know? So I will just finish on this point. It's funny how people make this caricature of the Bolshevik party, which was, according to them, this super undemocratic party ruled with an iron fist by Lenin, and everybody did whatever he said, and there was no place for critical thinking, there was no place for dissent and so on. This is complete historical falsification. That was the case, it's true, under Stalin, who wanted to consolidate his power and the power of his bureaucratic clique that was around him. But under Lenin, this party, I will make a very outrageous claim now, but I think it was the most democratic party ever to exist, because it had constantly, up until the revolution, it had constantly internal factions and debates and its own paper was hosting these debates. They were writing arguments against each other, fighting over various issues. Lenin himself, as a leader of the party, he found himself in a minority, sometimes in a minority of one, on several occasions. For example, when the Tsar, after the 1905 suppression of the revolution, and the Tsar created the fake parliament, the Duma, and the Bolsheviks were arguing between themselves whether to participate in those elections or not to participate. And initially, they agreed not to participate, but later on, Lenin, when he saw that the elections could have been a platform for the party to present itself to the masses, you know, use it as a platform, he said, no, we should participate. And the rest of the party said, no, you shouldn't. It's crazy. It's capitulating to our principles and so on. And he was the only one to argue his position. And he kept arguing his position by himself for a long period of time, you know. And he was the leader of the party. But he didn't force his opinion on the others, despite being the leader of the party. And this happened in 1917 when he came back to Russia during the first revolution of 1917, the bourgeois revolution in 1917. He said that that revolution would not be enough, that there needs to be a socialist revolution to actually fulfill the tasks, which were the giving land to the peasants and putting an end to war, basically, at the time. These were the main two tasks. And he said, this government, the provisional government, is not capable of doing that. We need to do that. We need to take power. And all the other leadership of the Bolshevik Party was saying, you're crazy. How can we do that? We have to work with this government. We have to collaborate with them. So again, he was in a minority of one, and he ended up, through his arguments, through his debate, democratic debate, he ended up winning over the members of the party, the rank and file. And then the leadership, the rest of the leadership, most of it, came to his side. But that's because he convinced the membership through constant debates and articles and so on. And I think this is it looks like, why are you talking about what happened 100 years ago? But it matters because we can learn from the kind of internal democracy that they managed to achieve at the time. But then when they acted outside, when they acted as a party, they acted in a super united and effective way. And that's how they managed to conquer power.
Mm-hmm. So I think a sort of lesson is to embrace internal struggle and to accept personal autonomy and individual autonomy, but to also accept that acting externally, parties should act as a unit.
Yes, exactly. That's how I would sum it up. And just to with the last mention, that of course this internal struggle has to be done in a calm, comradely way, you know, not without personal insults and so on. But it has to happen. Otherwise, the party will be captive to what two, three people think is best for the whole party.
If that's one of the problems I felt that if we were to frame these deliberate practices as debates, like we indeed are individual people arguing for our perspective, I think things wouldn't get as heated up. But since we are all under this guise of horizontalism and equality and consensus building, it felt like we were just talking with people who should already embrace our opinions, and we felt betrayed by them when they didn't held positions that we hold quite strongly, like very social justice issues or international justice issues. Like I don't know, there were some people who didn't prioritize the same as me women's struggle, or I didn't prioritize the same as them the problem of Venezuela, for example. When we didn't agree on this, it was because it felt like a betrayal, both to me and to them. If we were to accept that we are indeed different individuals and we are having a debate of ideas, it might have been more productive. And I think this maps out to how we started, because this is the effect that globalization has, that the theory is that we are all the states are in this common market and we are trading with each other freely and mutually beneficial, but instead they are invisible and unacknowledged lines of power that create oppressions. An internationalist view would respect the autonomy of various nations, but would still the nations should have this consciousness that we are still in a common struggle and we should cooperate. But
That should apply to the different oppressed groups in our movement. We should acknowledge the fact that there is a distinctive women's oppression. There is a distinctive oppression against people from the LGBTQ community. There is a distinct oppression in the case of Romania and the Eastern Europe in general, or against the Roma community. There is oppression against black people. It's not the case in Romania because we don't have a black community large enough to. But in Britain, in the United States, all these oppressions are distinctive, but at the same time, they are correlated. And yeah, they are not. We don't have to choose, because I like the fact that you mentioned the question, how important for you it was, the question of women's oppression in relation to how important it was for other people. I think it should be important for all of us. We don't have to choose between labor economic issues and oppression group issues, fight for women's emancipation and so on. This is a false dichotomy. We have to link them together because they are already linked together. I won't say that women oppression is completely reduced to class and economic issues, but is linked to class and economic issues. So, for example, the fact that the many women have to also work on the job market, but then also work maybe as hard at home to look after the children. They bear the biggest share of the domestic work. This has something to do with the kind of economic system we live in. Because in a socialist system, we would have public crèches, the kindergartens that would take a lot of the overload of the domestic work from women, which is currently performed majority by women, unfortunately. We would have canteens, so people won't have to cook as much as home. I mean, these basic concrete things that we don't think about, they have to do with the kind of socioeconomic structures we have. But I only wanted to kind of finish on this point about the unity of struggles. Starting from one of the points I made earlier about how the anti-austerity movement was very national-based compared to previous anti-globalization social movement, I think we are starting to overcome that. And there are two particular movements that are emerging, are developing, that have a strong international and internationalist character. And one is the women's movement, and the other one is the environmentalist movement. And I think as socialists, we have to engage as much as possible with these movements, because at the end of the day, we cannot ignore the women's oppression. We cannot ignore the devastation of the climate and of the environment around us. And we cannot ignore the relation between the kind of capitalist system we live in and these issues. And we have to show the link between overcoming these issues and the need for wider systemic change. For example, we have to show that there are no solutions to the question of climate change, the question of rebuilding the economy on a green basis, so to speak, for a so-called Green New Deal. We cannot achieve that on a capitalist basis, because in order to achieve that, we need a democratic control of the economy, of the resources, of the means of production, in order to serve the needs of the people and serve the needs of the planet itself. This is the last point that I think I wanted to make.
This is true. Like, there is a sort of technocratic liberal attack to the idea that democratic control of the means of production somehow runs against ecological issues. But for example, there's a factory in Romania that switched to producing vegetable-based products because because the workers simply couldn't work with meat anymore. And they were powerfully grossed out. They were afraid of the diseases that that work environment could create. And so they put pressure on the management and they switched to green, to vegan. I think these kinds of concerns come from a people looking down on average people, and people are smart. They're not an unthinking mass. Most people know what's good for them, and most people have some kind of selfishness to them, and this is how we are. Only if we are brutalized by capitalism, we become beasts, I think.
I fully agree with that, and I think that's a key kind of basic tenet of any socialist. It's the people know better because they know what their needs are. They know what their needs are. The market doesn't know what our needs are. The market only is there to make profit out of nothing for no reason, even if that is counterproductive to the whole planet. We know what the needs are, and we can decide how we can satisfy our needs in the best way. And the direct experience of this idea of democratic control, the idea that each sector of the economy would be under the democratic control of the people working in that sector. And of course, the consumers will also be included in the democratic process as well. But fundamentally, it's the people who actually work in that sector who know the best, know that sector the best, right? What that sector can achieve and so on. So why leave it to a few technocrats, as in capitalism, or a few bureaucrats, as in happened in the Stalinist regimes, to decide for the rest of the people? It's fundamentally, what is the source of, it's like an epistemological question. This is something that I've been thinking a lot about recently. That's why, sorry, I'm going a bit on about this, but it's an epistemological question, right? What is the source of knowledge about how to do things in society? And I think it's an empirical source of knowledge. It's from experience. For example, mothers, they have the experience of motherhood, of what it is to raise a child. They should be involved in the democratic decision of about childcare and education. They should be involved into designing the policies for childcare and maternity leave and all these policies that concern this particular topic, you know. So the same should apply to other aspects of social life.
Of course. Yeah. I think this is a pretty good place to wrap it up. So Romanian people would fund you on Mâna de Lucru, I guess, and on Critic Attack anymore?
I'm unfortunately I don't have time to write as much as I used to, but Mâna de Lucru is a group that is part of the International Socialist Alternative, the International Socialist organization that I've been a member of for almost 7 years now. And I'm a member here in Barcelona. I'm a member of the section here, which is called the Socialismo Revolucionario, Revolutionary Socialism. And we are active in over 30 countries. And the group in Romania is indeed Mâna de Lucru. So I contribute to the material from Mâna de Lucru, but also I write in English for the website of our international internationalsocialist.net website. So this would be the main places.
Okay. Thank you very much for coming on. It was a pleasure discussing with you.
It was a big pleasure to discuss, and thank you very much for the invitation. And the questions were very, very, very interesting, very exciting to discuss about.